recorded service. And today, if we were in church, we'd be celebrating Candlemas as we remember Christ, the light of the world. And of course, Candlemas is a very particular time of year. It marks the end of Epiphany season. And then we go back into ordinary time, which is our sort of a gentle growing time before we begin the next season in the church's calendar on Ash Wednesday as we move into the season of Lent. So today, as we remember Candlemas, as I say, we remember Christ, the light of the world. And as you see, we still have our crib up because our crib stays, giving the kings a chance to give their presents. The crib stays until the eve of Candlemas and marking, like I say, the end of Epiphany. And today we remember as Mary and Joseph bring the child Jesus to the temple to ask for God's blessing and to give thanks for his safe arrival. And we also meet Anna and Simeon. Anna, you know, an elderly woman who'd been widowed from a young age, and Simeon, an older man we're told, who's waiting for permission from God to be able to join his ancestors. He needs to wait for a particular moment, a sign from God. So within our story today, we have a scene with a baby, a young couple who have newly become parents, an old man waiting to meet his ancestors, and an old lady who has been widowed for a very long time. The theme that runs through this story is dedication. Dedication of people to God, people's faith, the dedication to waiting, to being patient, and most of all, God's dedication to us. So before we say any more about today, I'm going to ask Keith to read a poem for us. It's a poem, really it's for children, but it's a great way of expressing this particular story, this marker in our church year. And it's a lovely poem. So let's listen to Keith as he reads the poem for us.
A poem. A poem for Christ's presentation in the temple. "It's time to take the baby and give thanks to God," said Mary to Joseph one day. "With a prayer in our heart, we will take a small gift. It will help us to know what to say." The temple was huge on Jerusalem Hill, and they carried their baby with care up the steps to the court, where the service took place. What welcome would wait for them there? They queued with the rest who had babies in arms and watched for priests who would come to bless and to pray for the child that God sent, their precious and very dear son. All of a sudden, an elderly man to the temple came prayerfully in. He smiled at the baby and lifted him up, then strangely he started to sing. "Finally now I can die with real peace. I've seen that God's rescue has come. Wrapped up as a baby and held in my arms, salvation for everyone." Both Mary and Joseph were shocked and surprised by the strange words the old man did say. Their baby was special, but not just for them. A great light to rule all one day. The old man then added some words very dark, which Mary would find hard, very hard. The baby would grow and lift many up in a way that would just break her heart. The old man was joined by a grandmother now, who looked at the baby and ran, singing and shouting and jumping for joy. For she too had seen God's great plan. Mary and Joseph remembered that day, but kept it a secret untold, that Jesus would be God's rescuing King and light to lighten the world.
Lovely poem, isn't it? Maybe before we go on, let's just bow our heads in prayer for a moment. Lord Jesus, may we be always looking out for you like Simeon, always patient in our waiting for you like Anna, and faithful in your ways like Mary and Joseph. Amen. So let's listen to that reading from Luke's Gospel now. When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it was written in the law of the Lord. Every firstborn male should be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him into his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for the glory of your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher, and she was of great age, having lived with her husband for 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that time she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favour of God was upon him. Like I say, the presentation of the Lord to the temple is one of those points which is a rite of passage. And it's, we all have rites of passage in our life, different moments. But I think the thing that reminds me most of this rite of passage in our own life is our baptism. You know, when we come to our baptism, actually we don't have to be infants. We can be any age. when we come forward to be baptised. And when we're baptised, what we're doing is baptism, that's that word, it means a good drenching. What we are, we're drenched in the Holy Spirit. And you know, our prayer is, when we're drenched in the Holy Spirit, that, you know, as the Spirit moves and shapes our lives, we move to a point where we can eventually dedicate ourselves to God more formally. And when we're baptised, and if we're baptised later on as an adult, we're baptised and confirmed, usually at the same time, we're surrounded by friends and family of all ages, aunts, uncles, you know, mums, dads, brothers, sisters, cousins, of all ages, babies, young people. People, quite often, if you're having your baby baptised, then you've got friends and family maybe that already also have babies, so there are babies present. So baptism is a wonderful marker in our life, and it marks the beginning of our spiritual journey. And to mark that, we are given a light to carry out into the world. So we're drenched with the Holy Spirit, and then we're called by God, charged actually by God, to carry a light out into the world. And often we're given one of these, a candle. A baptism candle, it's a special candle reminding us the dove of peace. And this candle is lit from a very special candle. You know, Easter, one of my favourite services is on Holy Saturday, the eve of Easter Day, when after a whole season of Lent, when we've taken all the pretty decorations down, we have no flowers, and everything's quite bare and quite bleak. And then just as Easter arises, to give us the full pelt of the joy of Easter, when everything comes back in, we also bring the light back into church. Remember all creation and Christ, the light of the world. It is the most magical, magical service. Of course, we do that service in the evening to give us the full benefit of having the light of a candle. Now, when we give people their candle at baptism, if they're older, and even when they're babes and we give them to either their godparents or their parents to hold, we remind everybody, I always remind people actually, that, you know, it's not always easy to keep our flame alight, our candle alight outside the church building. You know, once we're inside, and we're all together, it's not that difficult to keep our light burning. But when we go out into the world with all the distractions and all the clamour and actually the darkness out there, it's not always easy to keep our candle burning. But we must keep it going, because that is our charge. And of course, sometimes our candle goes out for a bit. But you know, even if we allow our light to disappear for a little bit, we always can relight it. Because of course, the light of the world, the light that no darkness can overcome, will continue to burn. And all we have to do is put ourselves back in touch with the light, back in touch with the Lord. Because as you can see, you know, if we all keep our light burning, then that will prevent the darkness from overcoming. And the more of us that can keep our light burning, the more light there is in the world. And the way we do that is in every act of kindness, every act of love, every time we share either joy and laughter or tears with others, we're sharing the glory of God, we're sharing the light and the life and the love of God. And it's not ours, because it's been given to us. It's ours to share. It's ours to proclaim, to reflect the glory of God, that lovely light that keeps us all going. Sometimes it's, you know, especially at the moment, with the weather being so dreary and us all inside and not being able to share our lives in the same way that we have been used to doing, it can feel a bit glum. And sometimes the only thing that cheers us up is the light of a flame, of a candle burning brightly. Last week, we passed a terrible milestone in this pandemic, where we hit over 100,000 people having been lost to COVID-19. And the Archbishops of Canterbury and York have called us all to pause and pray. They've asked us from the 1st of February to take a moment at 6 o'clock in the evening, every evening, just spend a moment and pause and pray. To give thanks for all those who are doing their best to fight this pandemic. To remember all those who have lost loved ones. To pray for those who are working very hard, all those who are tired, parents at home, homeschooling, young children that are missing out on their, you know, social development, not just their education. The older people who are missing out, seeing the youngsters. Life. Sometimes prayer is very hard, and sometimes it's good for us to remember all we need to do is turn up, to just pitch up, and maybe just light a candle. So, you know, as we're all going to be pausing and praying at 6 o'clock, I would encourage you all maybe to find a candle and light it and stick it in your window so that everyone that's going by, as long as it's safe, obviously, you're not going to catch your curtains alight, but stick it in your window so everyone can see. And the more of us that have a light shining out in the darkness, the better it will be. Because the light that we carry comes from the light that the darkness will not overcome. So as we finish our time together today, let us pray. Lord Jesus, be in our lives. Help us to be as dedicated as Anna and Simeon. Help us to be able to wait patiently for the right moments as they did. Guide us so that we can be good reflections of your glory and your love. We know that sometimes when we feel that joy and your presence, as Anna and Simeon did, that it can be just a fleeting moment. Help us to share those moments. Help us to remember those moments so they might keep us going when times are hard and the darkness seems close. Lord Jesus, help us to dedicate our lives to keeping our light burning bright. The light that you gave us, a light and a call to shine in this world. No matter how dark sometimes life might feel. Pray for God's blessing on you this week. And I pray that maybe in those moments when you feel life's a bit too much, too difficult, too dark, that you can light a candle, pause, and spend a moment with God. Because all you have to do is turn up and the Lord will